Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to go through how to create an animation, something like this. So you can see we've got some crystals here that seem to grow along a curved path and move around as they do so. There's two basic ways that you can create these crystals. You can either just simply model them yourself and then use those, or you can create the crystals themselves from a geometry node setup. I've created a sub video to this one that goes into the geometry node setup for creating the crystals. The advantage of creating the crystals themselves with a geometry node setup is that you could change it in real time if you wanted. And of course you have lots of parameters that you can play around with, but it will work just as well for this animation if you just modeled it. I'm going to use the crystals that I created in that other tutorial. There's a link on the screen right now if you want to first drop to that other tutorial and have a look at the geometry node setup for that. This tutorial will also be a geometry node setup, but be a relatively simple one. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. Feel free to comment or ask questions or even dislike the video. And if you don't like the video, I'd be very interested to see what the issues you spotted were so that I can improve going forward. If you're a Patreon supporter, I do upload these files for any use available to my Patreon supporters, and I upload tutorials quite regularly. So let's start the tutorial. So what's on the screen at the moment is the geometry node setup for the crystal itself. And as I said, you can go to the other tutorial where I explain about that. There are a couple of crystal groups on here, so there is a little bit of complication there. But this could just as easily be a modeled crystal, just created by hand, as it were. So I'm going to grab that and just put that over to one side out of the way. And then I'm going to add, under curve, a Bezier curve. I found the Bezier seemed to work the best. And I'm going to scale it up a little bit so we can see what we're doing. Go into edit mode and then select one of the handles, the central point of it, press E, and then just move around a little bit. And I suggest moving and rotating as well, just to make it an interesting, almost knotted curve. And I'm going to select that point there and rotate it. So that's quite interesting. So we've got a randomish looking curve there. And the first thing we want to do is we want to see that curve animate, or be able to animate that curve. I've got another window open up here, and it's the geometry node window that I'm using. I've got my curve selected, so I'm just going to press new to create a new geometry node. We'll call this one curve in both areas. Just helps make sure you know which one you're in. So there's our group output, there's our group input. By default, there's not that many points on the node. We will likely need more. But for the moment, I'm just going to add, we'll search for it, a trim curve node. And I'll just drop that in there. And you can see we can select between either factor or length. I left it on factor, and you've got a start and an end. So if I, for example, take the end back, you can see the curve starts to disappear to there. And of course, you can do it the opposite way if you want to as well. So I'm now going to take that end and just take it out to here. You don't have to, but that just makes it easier to animate later on because we can obviously keyframe that value. So we've now got a value over here under the modifiers that will affect that curve. This next bit isn't strictly necessary, but I tend to do it anyway just because it helps when visualizing things. I'm going to add a join geometry node just to make sure I can still see that curve when it's there, even when I'm starting to add more nodes. Holding the shift key down, I'm just right clicking and dragging down just to give myself a little node here. And then I'm going to say instance on points, and I'm going to take that into there. And then the output of that, I'm going to take up to join geometry. Nothing much happening yet. And now whether it's modeled or whether it's a geometry node setup like this one, I need to bring this in. If it's a geometry node setup, if you click it, you'll go into a different geometry node. If you start dragging as soon as you click, you can just drag this crystal, as it were, straight into your geometry node setup and drop it there. So I can now take the geometry output of that into the instance input. And you can see initially it's rather large, so I'm just going to select the scale, and we'll just put this down to a small number to begin with. It's not quite that small. And you can see we've got some crystals, but they're all pointing the same way. They're all the same size, and there's not very many of them. And the reason for that is because we haven't got many points on our node as yet. And that's why we need to add another node in here. I'm going to add, if we search for it, a subdivide curve node, and we'll drop that there. And I put a subdivision of about 20, something like that. You can now see we've got a lot more points on that curve now. Probably afford to even go smaller just while we're showing what we're doing, and that's working a lot better. So next, rotation. So we don't want all the crystals rotated to look the same way, first of all. So we'll add under utilities a random value node. This time we'll change it to vector because we want random values for both x and y. Z doesn't really help us very much. So we'll drop that into rotation. And I believe they are radians, so one isn't what we want. We need just to go up to a much higher number. I use something 40 or 50, it doesn't matter. It's just got to be a lot bigger. And 20 or something there. So now you can see we've got crystals going in all sorts of different directions. It already looks better, but they're all the same size. And one of the things I wanted was I wanted the crystals to grow as the overall curve was extended. So fortunately, there is a node that will help us get that information, how long the curve or spline is, another name for a curve. So if we add a new node called spline parameter, slightly confusing, it's not curve parameter. Nevertheless, there it is. This will get the information that relates to that curve about how long the curve is and an index along there, how far along the curve we are at any given time. And I'll also add a map range node. So we want to map that output to a range that will be useful for our scale. The output's going to be a float because we want the same value for x, y, and z. And we're going to use the factor output of this spline parameter. So we'll take factor into that map range value, and then we'll take the result into scale. Obviously, that's quite large. So if I start to scale that back, what we'll actually see is that it's going the wrong way at the moment. You can see it's large at the end and small at the beginning. And what's happening is as we reduce the end of the curve, some of them are getting bigger. So it's actually upside down. So we'll need to do the same as I did the crystal making geometry node setup. I'm going to put 2 there and 0 there. And perhaps we'll go even smaller than that. Let's try 1 or even 0.5. It all depends on the scale of your particular setup. So now that's much better. So now you can see we've got our initial crystal generated there. But then as I start to move up on the scale, more crystals appear, very small at first, and then start to grow along the path of the curve. And of course you could increase, this is the joy of geometry nodes, you can add more cuts if you want to. You could go up to 40. Doesn't change the size of anything, but it gives you lots more subdivisions, so they'll be almost as if they were joined when they started. It's a more organic looking growth. You could add a random factor in there as well if you wanted to, so that it was less linear, but because it's a randomized crystal already, I think it looks fine. And they're not all the same size because it depends how far along the curve they are. And you can adjust the max size of the crystals here. So if we go to 0.075 in this case, the actual numbers you'll need will depend on your initial setup. And then if you modeled it, you can have applied your material directly. But if you didn't, if you used a geometry node setup to create your crystals, then they won't have a material to start with. So at this point, you probably want to add one. That is actually my object with my geometry node instance in it. So if we go to search set material and then drop that in there, come down to here, and we'll create a material and we'll call that crystal. Just going to go to the world, say use nodes, environment texture, and I'll just add an HDRI just to give us some light in the scene. Come back to my crystal and let's just make it a metal crystal to begin with, and we'll turn metallic right up and roughness quite a long way down. And I'm going to go to EV, we'll turn on bloom, ambient occlusion, screen space, reflections, and we'll see what that looks like. And having created the material, we just need to go into our set material node and select that material. There we go. We can now see we've got our crystalline, our growing crystalline curve. At the moment, it's not animated, obviously. It's very easy to do. I'm at frame 1. I'll set the end point to 0, press I on that, then go to the end frame, set that up to 1, press I over there. And the only other thing I'll generally do is click here on that little keyframe and set the interpolation mode, in this case, to linear. Now, if we play that, you can see we've got our crystals growing before our very eyes. There will be a link to the sub-tutorial for the geometry node setup to create the crystal itself. But as I said, you can just as easily just model it and drag that in as I did. To give you a final look, here's the relatively simple geometry node setup for this element. If you enjoyed this tutorial, don't forget to like and subscribe. If you've got some questions or you have some suggestions on alternative methods or criticisms of the method I've used, do please comment below. It helps me out if you comment and if you like or even dislike the video. Otherwise, I will see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.